Good morning. We are so glad that you have joined us on this morning and have taken the time. We'd like to welcome you and also remind you today that all are invited to the Lord's table. We call it the Lord's table because it is the Lord's table, not ours. All those who are baptized in the name of Christ are welcome to it, and we look forward to this joyful day of celebration. Today is All Saints Sunday, so you are welcome to feel like a saint or a sinner. Or a sinner who's a saint. And that's what we're going to talk about in a second. I know it's confusing. I think a lot of people went out this morning with their heads turning. It's like, so am I a saint? Am I a sinner? Saint, sinner? But today we have a special group with us, our fellow, the rest of our family from House of Hope. So welcome. Thank you for joining us and being with us. And I want to invite Corey to come for a second, Corey Blaine, and tell you something about this young man. First of all, it is just a joy with the hospitality that I've received being with you guys when I came the other day. It's just amazing. And I want to thank you for what you're doing. I want to thank Pastor Malcolm, who's not with us, and he's actually at the hospital recovering. So we want to keep him in prayers, especially this week. So Corey Blaine, and I invited him especially on this day. I figured, look, you know, this guy has been recognized, and he has received the Commissioner's Leadership Award. And he has been, yes, we are, yeah. And he has done amazing work, and I thought, you know what, the least we can do is join in this celebration and this joy that you have had and tell you how much we are appreciative of what you're doing and how God is continuing to bless you. So I've asked Corey if you'd like to share a word. You're welcome to use the mic over there. And as he's doing that, I'd like to ask for this presentation in 1 minute. Go ahead. Go ahead, Corey.
All right. Hi, my name is Corey Blaine, and I wanted to say that the only way I could have even been able to receive the Commissioner's Leadership Award of 2018 was because with God and with my House of Hope family, and without them, I would still be in my drug addiction, and it was not good for me. And I think the House of Hope for supporting me and giving me encouraging words, and I thank them for supporting me in every way that they do. They're so polite and so nice and kind towards me, and it gives me strength, and that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, Corey. You know, he said you guys were nice and polite. I know that's not the case all the time, because when I came in last time, there was some trouble, but it was good trouble. So thank you, and thank you so much for this. Now, here's the thing. This one says amazing grace, and to me, what is amazing about grace is that it continues to amaze us. God is unbelievable how God works in our lives and continues to reform us and continues to teach us, and as how God continues to prepare us. I mean, it's amazing to me. So I want to present you this on our behalf to say that our prayers are with you and with all the people at House of Hope, and thank you so much for what you do and the amazing life. Know that your family is here. You are our family. We are your family. And together we will continue to lift and give the glory to our Lord Jesus. Thank you so much, Corey. Welcome. Thank you. So a couple of the announcements to share with you. Pastor Dean Piper will begin a Hope University series on the Gospel of Matthew. So you are welcome to join. That's November 6th and 7th. We have our Wednesday evening prayers will begin this coming Wednesday, November 7th at 6 o'clock. So we have our dinner and fellowship there. But at 6, you are welcome to join and gather in the sanctuary for an evening prayer. I know some of you have been looking forward to that, just to have a time to center ourselves midweek. So that would be great. Also, for those who have been asking about the cantata tickets, the cantata is coming up. We know Christmas is coming up. We first have to go through Thanksgiving. but, of course, the tickets will be available beginning next weekend. And next weekend is the Joy of Giving weekend. So you're welcome to those tickets, as well as you can reach anyone at the office after November 11th if you would like to receive some tickets. The new members class, November 8th and 15th, we welcome our new members. If you are interested in becoming a new member, check the box that says wish to join right there on the attendance pad. So we look forward to that class, and for those who would like to join, they are welcome to spread the word as well. The next class will be in January. Our Men of Hope breakfast, they make, from what I understand, the last time around I was there, the breakfast wasn't too bad. You know, actually, it really was good breakfast. So you can come and enjoy the breakfast and the fellowship Thursday at 8 a.m. That's next Thursday. Today, our prayers are with Eleanor's family, Eleanor Bell. She had passed away and gone to the eternal life November 1st. So we want to keep her family in prayer, especially Roger and the rest of the family. For those who would like to volunteer, on November 14th, we have the Thanksgiving dinner. And a couple of our volunteer staff have health-related issues, so they cannot be there. If you would like to step in and help out, please let us know. And this will be for November 12th and 13th to do some prep work. So contact Chef Debbie or the church office if you can help or you would like to help. Finally, November 9th, right here in the sanctuary, will be the Brothers in Song concert. And if you need tickets, they are at the village's box office, but we will continue to lift the group in prayer as they gather here and lift up their talents and gifts. Now I invite you to share the peace of Christ with one another. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Lord, save through the merry words read.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Let us pray together. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessing saints in lives lived among us, and to know the irrepressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now bands of raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. "By all means go," the king of Aram replied. "I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So Naaman left, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of Israel read, "With this letter, I'm sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of his leprosy." As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, "Am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me?" When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message, "Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman went with his horses and chariots and stopped at the door of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, "Go, wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be cleansed." But Naaman went away angry and said, "I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, wave his hand over the spot, and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be cleansed?" So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servants went to him and said, "My father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not done it? How much more then when he tells you, 'Wash and be cleansed'?" So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. Then Naaman and all of his attendants went back to the man of God. He stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the world except in Israel." The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 8th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said, "be clean." Immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. Then Jesus said to him, "See that you don't tell anyone, but go and show yourself to the priest and offer the gift of Moses commanded as testimony to them." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The good that I do, people never remember. But the bad that I do, people never forget. It's a quote that I could never forget. The good that I do, people never remember. The bad that I do, people never forget. There is no doubt a human tendency to dwell on what is not well. It's kind of like that built-in GPS in the human mind that moves towards what is negative, what is missing, what is imperfect, what is just not quite right. Now remember for a moment the last time you lost something. Let's say it could have been last night or this morning. It doesn't matter what goes on around you at that moment. The only thing that you are focused on is that there is something missing. And you will not rest, neither anyone around you for that matter, until you find it or come to a conclusion that you can never find it and grieve over it. That means going through the so-called five stages of loss and grief. Now, I know those stages are reserved for a deeper kind of loss, but I think they pretty much apply to any stage when we lose just about anything. First is denial. I just can't believe that I lost my phone. This can't be happening. Second thing is anger. How could I do that? How could I be so sloppy or misplace it? I know I just had it in my hand. Then it's bargaining. If I only could have bought that phone case for $5.99, I should have got that case. If I find it, I will never let go of it again. I will never do this again. If I only could find this phone. Then it's depression. Now we're all sad because we lost it. We worry about the cost of a new phone and how we're going to get a new one and spend the same money on the same item once again. Finally, it's acceptance. We finally accept that we have lost it. We move on, get a new one, try to enjoy the new one that we got. If anything, these stages, they can show us how much the mind can go through in the face of loss. There are no five stages for gaining, by the way. When we gain, it's simply get it, got it, good, that's it. Imagine when our minds are consumed with what is missing, or what is negative, or what is lost. We cannot see the positive of the moment no matter what, and no matter how positive it is. When you have lost something, it doesn't matter that it's sunny and beautiful on the outside. It doesn't matter that there is one-of-a-kind sunset that evening. It wouldn't make any difference that Thanksgiving is just around the corner and Christmas right after. The feeling is not limited to losing something, but also the feeling that something is missing. When we keep thinking something is missing in our lives, we go through similar emotions, as if losing something, not having enough money, not having many or any friends, not feeling physically fit, or having imperfect health. After all, we have been conditioned, our mind has been conditioned to focus on what is negative. The brain itself is trained to identify with feelings of discomfort in the body and imposes pain as a sign of warning that something is not right. Actually, pain is only a warning sign that something is not right. Now, it is painful, but that's all it is. So in other words, pain in our body continues to give us a signal that something is not, or something is missing. That's how the body works. The feeling that I call a tendency to dwell on what is not well truly drains our energy. It just sucks the joy out of our lives. But what's worse yet is when we apply this whole process, the tendency to dwell on what is not well, unto others. It is much easier to see the bad flaws in others, or that which is bad, than that which is good. Now, this area specifically, I believe we have complete control over. What we see in the other person is completely up to us. It does not depend on what they do. It does not depend on who they are. Listen to Romans chapter 2, as Paul says. Look, you say, we know that God's judgment on those who do such things is in accordance with truth. Do you imagine, whoever you are, that when you judge those who do such things, and yet do them yourself, you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you despise the riches and kindness of God? That do you not realize that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? Dwelling on the shortcomings of others may be an excuse for us to feel good about ourselves at times, as if we don't have them, or as if our shortcomings are not as bad as theirs. Our sins are not as great in comparison to what they have done. We might laugh at those who cry, as if for us it does not hurt, or mock the ones who fail, as if we have never failed before, or giggle at someone who messes up, as if we have never messed up before, or raise our eyebrows because someone lost their way, as if we always knew where to go, or call them cunning and deceitful when they don't tell the truth, but when we do it, it was just a white lie. Somehow, even in Jesus' time, people managed to find a negative that did not exist in the one who was perfection, right? Simply from his ordinary life. They said, well, isn't he from Nazareth? And isn't he the son of Mary? And Mary was just an average poor girl. Isn't he the son of Joseph? Well, Joseph was no brain surgeon. He was just a carpenter. So all this negativity can throw us between shame and guilt. And here, it's just worth for a moment to distinguish such emotions, because I believe sometimes we confuse them all together. And as under the self-image depression trauma study, it says this. First, shame means I am wrong. Guilt means I did something wrong. There's a big difference between I am wrong and I did something wrong, right? Shame hurts our self-image and our belief that we can change things we don't like about ourselves or our situation. Guilt is about feeling badly about a mistake. Now, see, somebody did find their phone finally. Shame does not lead to positive change, but guilt does. So guilt can inspire us to act differently in the future, right? Guilt can help. Shame always leads to disconnection from others, but guilt can lead to healing. Confessing our sins, our mistakes, actually allows us to be open emotionally to others. So guilty feelings can prompt us to build a connection through communication or changed behavior. Shame prevents us from feeling or strong enough to confess our sins in the first place. Shame is internalized and deeply connected to our sense of who we are. Guilt is often passing. Shame is never healthy or useful. Guilt can be healthy and useful. How we convey negative feedback matters. It can work better to simply state the harm caused than to shame the other person. Shame is about causing pain for an individual. Guilt is usually associated with accountability. Comments that create guilty feelings are about communicating pain or disappointment without casting negativity on the person as a whole. Shame underlies a host of psychosocial problems like depression and substance abuse and infidelity and others, but guilt does not. With so much that is just imperfect and missing in our lives, we might think being a saint is just a dream. Who can be a saint, right? On this All Saints Sunday, who does not like to be called a saint? The one thing I remember and I like about All Saints is that they were all sinners. No exception. They were all sinners. I mean, look at Peter, for example. Peter, we call him sometimes the rock. But really, Jesus, when he talked to Peter, he did not call him the rock. He called him a pebble. Because he said, you are Petros from Greek. He said, you are Petros. And Petros means pebble, doesn't mean rock. He said, you are Petros. And on this Petra, it changed. On this Petra, I build my church, which is Petra means rock. So in other words, like Jesus saying, you are a pebble, and on this rock, I will build my church. Jesus is the rock, not Peter. Jesus is the rock of our faith. But this Peter, how can someone who publicly denied Jesus, someone who was doubtful, someone who was weak in his faith, and at times even abandoning Jesus altogether, be called a saint? Mary Magdalene, we sing with the cherubim and the seraphim, with Mary Magdalene, we say, holy, holy, holy. But Mary Magdalene was anything but holy. Mary Magdalene had not just one or two or three, but seven demons, if you remember, when Jesus came to her. One of my favorites that I quote every day is St. Paul. And St. Paul, how can someone like Paul be called a saint, the one who gave his whole life to the persecution of Christians and newly converts, persecuting them, even killing them, breaking every commandment from thou shalt not murder to thou shalt not bear false witness. St. Paul not only is called a saint today, but he contributed to one-third of that whole New Testament that we have in our hands. And what about calling some of the Corinthians saints back then? Today we say walk like an Egyptian, but back then it was really live like a Corinthian. Literally, that was the quote, live like a Corinthian, because Corinthians were known to indulge in a life of immorality. But Paul calls them saints, and Paul would address the church as saints, even ancient saints, the ones we do not say like Saint David. I mean, we should be saying Saint David, right? Or Saint Moses. It doesn't rhyme. But really, they were saints, right? But look, David, we know, committed murder and adultery. Moses had a kill-and-run situation, if you remember, when he saw one who was abusing one of the Hebrew slaves. Jacob, deception is in his name. The word Jacob means Yaakov, Yaqub, which means the one who holds in the heel of others. Because if you remember, Esau was born first, and Jacob came second, and he was holding the heel of his brother. That's why the word Jacob, Yaakov, means the one who is a deceiver also. the one who deceives. And not only he was married once, we know that, but not twice, not three times. He had four wives, if you remember, Rachel and Leah and Bilhah and Zilpah. But even more from the ancient founding fathers like Saint Augustine of Hippo that I love so much. I mean, I love this guy. He was considered to be the doctor of the church and one who had an 11-year-old fiancé. This engagement did not last. But also he had not a life with a wife, but he had his life with a concubine. And he was famous for his quote, "Lord, grant me chastity and continence, but not yet." And one that I love so dearly was Saint Francis of Assisi. Francesco, his father, called him Francesco, which meant the Frenchman. What is interesting about St. Francis as we approach Christmas is that he was the one who arranged the first Christmas manger back in 1224, and he died during the evening hours of October 3rd, 1226, while listening to Psalm 140. St. Francis had an early life of wealth and extravagance, bright clothing, rich friends, and the love of pleasure. He was disillusioned by the world and its materialism, until his life was changed when he first met a beggar. Saints and sinners, Luther would say, the paradox of good and evil remains in the person until death. Luther had pointed out, saint by faith, but sinner by nature. But there is a difference between sinner and sinners, Luther would say. He says, look, there are some sinners who confess that they have sinned, but do not long to be justified. Instead, they give up hope and go on sinning so that when they die in despair. And while they live, they are enslaved to the world. There are other sinners who confess that they sin and have sinned, but they are sorry for their sins. They hate themselves for it. They long to be justified, and under groaning constantly, they pray to God for righteousness. These are the people of God, the saints who are saved in spite of their sins. You know, Paul could see sinners as saints in and through Christ. As a matter of fact, the word Christian appears only three times in the New Testament, but the word saint appears 60 times. Paul has referred to the people of Corinth and Ephesus and Colossians as saints. He continued to say that through Christ, sinners are sanctified, they are redeemed, they are made holy again. The word sanctified from Greek means to be set apart for God, to make something holy as an offering, as a sacrifice. Peter, Mary Magdalene, Paul, Moses, David, Jacob, Augustine, Francis, you and I, and everyone else who believes in Jesus, are all sanctified. They are all set apart by God and by His glory through the forgiveness of our sins by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is what Paul says in Romans 5, while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, through perhaps for how much more for a good person, right? But God proves His love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely than now that we have been justified by His blood, will we be saved through Him. Perhaps it is the story of why God chose Jesus the way He did in the first place. Not from a priestly and perfect family, but from a lineage, as mentioned in Matthew and chapter 1. He said that He was chosen from Judah, the father of Perez, and Zerah by Tamar, and Solomon, the father of Boaz, by Rahab, and Jesse, the father of the king of David. A reference to less than a perfect lineage of Tamar and Rahab. There is a purpose why they were mentioned, to show that even the Savior of the world had come. God has chosen the weak. God had chosen the imperfect. God had chosen sinners to bring His Savior from that lineage. And yes, the prophecy of can anything good come out of Nazareth, even choosing Him to come out of Nazareth. See, the good that I do, people never remember. The bad that I do, people never forget. But thank God that God, with God, it's a whole different story. For now, in Christ and through Christ, we are cleansed from all unrighteousness. We are forgiven from our sins, and our sins are forgotten. We are made whole through His blood. And now when I confess my sins with all my heart, I know that the blood of Jesus, that the bad that I did because of the blood of Jesus, the bad that I did, God never remembers. And now the good that I will do, God will never forget. All saints then, we are all sinners. But God could not remember the bad that they did. That's why the sinners have become saints, because of the blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary. Today, to our Lord Jesus, be all praise, all riches, wealth, power, and honor, now and forever. Amen. Living together in trust and hope as sinners who have been sanctified and now are saints, let us together confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Let us pray. Lord God, friend of those in need, your Son Jesus has untied our burdens and healed our spirits. We lift up the prayers of our hearts for those still burdened, those seeking healing, those in need within the church and the world. Today, the saints crowd around us, and we are grateful for friends who made us laugh so hard that it hurt, for parents with the lessons it took us so long to learn, for siblings holding our shared past, for mentors with their particular wisdom. We carry all of their legacy with us. For grace or pain that came through them, we are grateful, and also grief-filled, angry, and resentful, and lost. Today, feeling the presence of the saints around us, we remember them by name. Mary Schmidt, Walter Morey, Dorothy Osdale, Lorraine Rudy, Al Tamino, Jan Hennessy, Don Anderson, Eleanor Mollenhauer, Phil Stravino, Janet Vain, Virginia Zimmerman, Marjorie Browett, Jean Beringer, Barbara Plant, Gary Mohan, Donald Bretz, Joe Hatcher, Gordy Metcalf, Irv Vigut, Joe Schnur, Hubert Hube Hansen, Bill Anderson, Roland Resch, Edward Brown, Mo Jorgensen, K. Kent Evenstadt, Judy Wolitz, Janice Weingartner, Richard Davis, Andrew Zimmerman, Ray Schnabel, Ruth Smith, Jean Lee, Bob Cherry, Alfred Gutenknecht, Keith Groner, Arlene Graceff, Bob Spears, Patricia Cruz, Joanne Artman, Marion Zielinski, Robert Siebold, Dottie Kopenhofer, Kristen Bonilla, Elizabeth Spears, Joyce Brooks, Manuel Manny Knutson, Irma Benner, Ken Swanson, Jack Shadell, Jackie Merriman, Florence Edgar, Leila Radar, Jean Tilley, Bob Robert Walters, Fran Seidel, Judy Boots, Kenneth Christie, Sarah Chris Curry, Harold Hansen, Donna Hartfield, Richard Miller, David Martin. Today, feeling their presence around us, may we receive the blessing that we need and return our thanksgiving to you, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God, we thank you for those unnamed people among us who speak up for the sick and the marginalized, whom you generously lavish with your grace. We give thanks for your powers of healing and mercy, which you shower on us every day. Strengthen our faith so that we may see your fingerprints everywhere. And when we hear your voice, help us to follow. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father God, you know the desires of our hearts and you know the prayers in our hearts, but not yet on our lips. Be with those who have asked for us to pray for them, for those who can't remember any longer, and the people who care for them, for those who are struggling with new diagnosis and the family that surrounds them, for all those difficult things in our lives that your whispered peace can soothe, we now ask in our hearts or out loud on our lips. All this we ask before you, Lord, in your mercy. O God of compassion, through the witness of our captive maidservant, you healed Naaman in the waters of the Jordan. Through Jesus, you healed lepers. Heal us so that we may follow Christ with joy, giving thanks with all our being through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty and Merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who after his resurrection sent forth the apostles to preach the gospel and to teach all nations and to promise to be with them always, even to the end of the age. And so with all the glorious company of the apostles and with the choirs of angels and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Indeed holy, almighty and merciful God, you are most holy, and great is the majesty of your glory. You so loved the world that you gave your only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. We give you thanks for his coming into the world to fulfill for us your holy will and to accomplish all things for our salvation. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us now join hands and speak together the prayer which our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Broken and divided, we are united in the blood and the body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Come to the banquet, for all is now ready. Please be seated. and as you're able. The body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen you and keep you in God's grace.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Christ is with you. Thank you.